just flying through this foreclosure documentation that I got through from the Supreme Court. So bear with me. First part's probably a little slow, but you're going to probably learn something because this is real-time foreclosure, watching the foreclosure machine just churn out the documents. So this, I'm going to blast through these documents. This is what I got from the courts, which is from the lawyer who's representing the bank. So petition to court. There's not much here. The interesting thing here is the boxes. There's three boxes here. That means those entities, anything inside the box does not exist. It's on a different plane. So I'm just starting to learn all how the documents are laid out and the parsing and stuff like that. So I'm going to be hopefully educating you people who are kind of coming along for the ride on this. So that's something to take note of. Page 3. So also I'm doing this so you guys can kind of see, because this is just a standard format that they churn out. This is the foreclosure machine at its best. So I'm kind of giving you a heads up on the actual process here too. Page 4. So they want me to pay. These are the orders that they're trying to get from the judge. Factual basis. They don't mention that the UCC filings by the One People's Public Trust has actually put them in foreclosure. Or possibly put them in foreclosure. I'm starting to have some doubts about that. But anyways. Page 6. Hopefully I didn't miss any pages, but I'll be covering it later on in my rebuttal. So here we go again. So this is where the judge signs. If he signs this, that means that all the orders that they've asked for, they can proceed with. But again, this is in a box, which means that it's on a different plane. This does not exist on this document. So his signature is basically a fiction for them to get to do something. There's not much here. I think the court number is right there. So this is their affidavit. Again, standard stuff. I, Kathy, blah, 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 blah. And so she's coming from Toronto, and she filed in Vancouver. Don't know how that can happen. That's kind of just goofy how we've now switched from one legal firm to another. Litigation officer for the petitioner. Blah, 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 blah. So there you have it. Okay, so here's the land title form. Very interesting. The lawyer who did the conveyancing didn't tell me that he actually worked for the bank, and you can see that his name is in a box on this document, which means he does not exist. So that's double misleading. One, he didn't tell me that he was working for the bank. Two, on the document he doesn't exist. So and we're just chipping through. So this is more of the optics that I'm kind of showing you here. There is some other goofy stuff here. The lady and her address is now from New Westminster, but the stamp is from Ontario, or for the province of Ontario. So I don't know. There's a commissioner for the Ontario, blah, 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 bank, for the Toronto bank. There's also a hyphen in there, which also means something, too. Each day of the month is in a box. This is in a box. This is in a box. All this stuff does not exist. The only thing that exists is the top part here. And the bottom part, because it's actually broken there. There's a tiny hairline crack right there. So this exists. This bottom line exists. And the top line exists. But the stuff in the middle is a fiction, doesn't exist. Actually, the whole thing's a fiction. So, there you go. Okay, another page. Lots of little boxes here. So that no is in a box, does not exist. That yes in a box does not exist. Freehold does not exist. And some of this interesting. So expiry date, that there does not exist. And it doesn't look like it's actually signed. And there's actually another lawyer firm on here. So this is page 2 of 4. There you go. So this is page 3 of 4. Again, a box with an X in it doesn't exist. So all these boxes that they're asking for this information, general provisions, doesn't exist. Fixed rate mortgage, never happened. Only because I kind of believed it happened. Page 404, only thing ticked here is section blah blah blah, is closed mortgage, fixed rate, pay, I don't know what that is there. So here we go. These are the forms. They're very sticky about the forms. You have to use their PDF form format in the courthouse. So to find these forms, Google Form 109 Supreme Court BC or whatever, and then you come to the Supreme Court, it's top of the link, and here's all the forms. Now, I haven't gone through all of these, I just chipped through a couple of them, and I got some great ideas. The demand to produce documents form, and also the countersuit form, so I'm countersuing the bank for $10 million as well as a whole bunch of other stuff. So, when I get some time, I will blast through some of these forms. And there's even, I think I noticed, an admiralty law form in here somewhere, which is cool. I'll have to study up on admiralty law. But anyways, that's that there. So going through the form that I filled out, the first thing here is affidavit. So they kind of keep track of how many affidavits are going back and forwards between you. That's kind of cool. This number was assigned from the courts, which was when they started the process. And I made a mistake. I put down the Robson Street, but it's not. It's actually the Vancouver Registry. So that was kind of one of my big mistakes at the court registry there. Another thing, uppercase lettering means fiction, doesn't exist. Very, very interesting how the key things here are in uppercase. So, the accommodation party I got out of the Bills of Exchange Act, they actually specify that there is such thing as an accommodation party, which is someone who actually takes responsibility, can sign for someone, but doesn't reap any benefit. So, I kind of am liable for my statutory entity or the fiction person, all uppercase person. So I put that in there. That's how I have to come into the court. And paramount security holder basically means that the buck stops here. I'm responsible. It's my house. If they're entrapping or doing something to the fiction me, it's my flesh and blood and energy that has to make the money to bail out the fiction me. So again, I'm following their format, but this is uppercase. Uppercase means it's fiction, just like on front of a boat. An incorporated company is all uppercase. That means they've created a fictitious entity that takes the liability from them. There's definitely two worlds here. One is fact, one is fiction. And in court, they don't want fact in court. So I'm trying to enter court as a accommodating party, which is real, the real me. So anyways, I go through account number on my birth certificate trust. That is the trust in Victoria, created when my parents or the government actually filled in the birth certificate, which is a kind of deceptive because you've kind of signed away the rights to your child to the state in exchange for benefits and privileges of being part of society in a fictitious format. So anyways, on the back of my birth certificate in the previous video, you'll see very plainly that there is an account number pointing to the treasury. And that was a good piece. That was kind of like a big breadcrumb that was left for me. That it was gnawing at me for months. I had it sitting beside my computer, and it just didn't dawn on me why someone would put a receipt number and a account number pointing to the treasury in Victoria. So I've kind of got the pieces now for that. And also my SIN number to access your trust account. I've been told that you take the dashes out of this, and federally can give you permission to access your provincial trust account using these two numbers. So you need the account number for your trust in Victoria, plus you have to, on the forms to fill out to access your trust, you need to take the dashes out. But I'll get into that in another day. So here and after known as statutory entity. This is a legal term that basically means that's a fancy legal word for straw man, fictitious person. So there you go on that. Affidavit again is uppercase. It means it doesn't really exist. Respondent intends to make both parties whole in this matter. That being said, the respondent believes that there is a possibility of deceptive and dishonorable practices have been committed in regards to the alleged debt claimed by the petitioner, its employees, agents, here and after called petitioner. Now, when I first kind of started this, I had 21 days to do this. I did it in 14 days. I wanted 7 days in case I had to drive to Vancouver, do something, redo something. I just needed a comfort zone. I also have grade 6 education and I'm illiterate. So I'm telling you, if I can chip through this stuff and do it, you guys surely can. So, anyways, I was going to go at this. They're fraud. They're making money from nothing. They're crooks and blah, blah, blah. And I was, I had a whole bunch of stuff written out that I was just going to slam them. And then as I started piecing more things together, I got kind of more enlightened. And basically, they're not really that. They're kind of doing it legally. Now, with the type of money the banks deal with, they can buy laws. But that being said, as you'll see as I go through this, that they're definitely deceptive and they're definitely dishonorable. But fraudulent, criminal, we'll see. Not in regards to what's happened to me, possibly. The interest and shifting from one account, a tax account, to pay interest on loans, I think that could be fraudulent, could be criminal, but I'm not really addressing that. I'm kind of coming at them straight on a philosophical kind of low level. Where'd you get the money? Prove loan, prove loss, prove harm. That's, other people have won their mortgages by finding paperwork technicalities that the bank has screwed up. I'm not really going at it. That is one of my angles, kind of, but I'm really going straight on, where'd you get the money from? Kind of approach. So anyways, let's go through the meat of my affidavit here on another form, because I had to attach it to this one. Okay, let's fly through this. This is the attached affidavit to the affidavit form 109. The top part is the same. Brief history. Born an orphan, adopted and taken in many names, adoptee parents a few times. It was not until age 14 or 15 the statutory entity had an idea what the real name was, being technically illiterate. The staff at the group home filled in the forms for the ID. Basically, this is this paragraph here is laying out why there's a small misspell in my name. There's a letter wrong in it. So, and then I'm saying why it is. Like, I used everything for legal purposes, so it didn't really matter to me. But now that I've started to dig into this, there is a big difference in if the name is spelt wrong, it's a different person, especially when they're dealing with fictitious people that they're making up just because it's an uppercase or lowercase. So in two areas, it's wrong. One, the statutory or the fictitious person, the statutory entity, is uppercase, is supposed to be attached to a real person in lowercase, but in this case, it's an uppercase person, not really being attached backwards to a real person because there's a misspell in the name. So how can you assign legal responsibility to that? And how did they go into my trust account when on the forms it's not the same person as the trust account that they access? So there's an issue there. The premise of the petitioner's claim is the loan was made in dishonor of the alleged loan happened, the loss of harm were the result to the petitioner. This is kind of what there's another form that this goes on. The history of the origin of the funds in dispute, where did they get them from? Prior title of funds, okay. The prior title would be my trust account. Ownership and rights of funds, which would be my trust account. Now, they're going to have to do some fancy auditing to backtrack this. Everything is trackable in the bank, you would think. Anyways, can the petitioner produce documentation of actual transaction and transfer of said funds from the petitioner to the statutory entity? And part of that is, did I get a receipt for my promissory note? No, I didn't. Did they sign on the promissory note? No, they didn't. It's a one-way transaction. So anyways, and now this is the kicker here. Go back three generations. So they have to go back three transactions, which should cover them taking it, putting it off books, and then loaning me money, attaching that money from off books to on books back to me. So that should wrap up that, but we'll see what happens. So now this is why is this speaking so fast there? Okay. So this is kind of my little rambling on here of the stuff that I have figured out. Research has revealed, I should have put my research, but anyways, myths and half-truths, truths that are so hidden and far from mainstream society thinking, it's hard to believe even when the evidence is complete and impartial. So now I've gone through, the banks collect society savings and lend them out and charge interest as a management fee for their services. Now, in a legal document, italic, is kind of like capitals, doesn't really exist on the page. So anyways, that's in the Stiles manual, and I'm just going to be getting into the Stiles manual when I go through their mortgage agreement, which is interesting that they didn't ship me the mortgage agreement. They shipped me the table of contents for the mortgage agreement on their documents from the Supreme Court. That's really odd. Okay, so most people are in debt and the true savings are quite scarce. Half truth, the scarce savings are used for fractional lending. So you need $10 clear title in a savings account, and then they can lend out, or it looks like they're making from nothing, $90. So they can actually, but that actual money is coming from the trust accounts. So it looks like they're making money from nothing, but they're not. So the fractional lending is just a check and balance in the big scheme of things here. So banks make money from nothing, keystrokes on a computer. That's another myth. If this was true, Toyota would not ship 1,000 cars to Canada if they knew banks could just pay for them with a few keystrokes, which is true. There has to be value behind the money. And it's against the UCC regulation to create an enforceable security. There are three requirements. A secured party must give value. Keystrokes compared to making 1,000 cars. You know, you could do the keystrokes in 30 seconds and it would take, 1,000 people, 10,000 people, for the whole chain, a year to make a 1,000 cars. So it's, no, there has to be value there. Banks are required to have $10 of every $100 created in a savings account unallocated to money creation if they make, basically this is fractional lending, what I just mentioned. Fractional lending is a check in the checks and balances of the banking system. It looks like they've created money from nothing because they're unaware that the 90% actually came from statutory entity birth estate trust account. After moving away from the gold standard, there's nothing back in our money. There's actually something very precious back in our money, our currency, Canadians' future earnings. And that's when they, some countries just put a lump sum in the United States, the federal government, when someone's born and they actually apply for the birth certificate, then they, the federal government puts in $1 million, the state puts in $900,000. In Canada, in my trust account originally, I think there was $700,000 put in. I am getting the documents for this from another individual who says he has them. So hopefully when that, but then there's compounded interest on top of that. And there also could be, once you start earning money, they can, you know, based on your income tax filings, blah, blah, blah. So there might be a whole bunch of formulas to boost or decrease the amount of money in your trust account. But anyways, our future earnings, that trust account set up is what backs our money. It's the most precious. And it's kind of hard to hoard our earnings, because if you just hoard it too much, we're not going to work. You know, and so where gold you can hoard. So anyways, I personally think it's a pretty good system. So how the alleged loan transpired is as follows. The respondent believes, upon submitting birth certificate application to the government, item 6, that's my birth certificate, the following transpired. The Treasury added the yearly, I just covered this, a father income divided by 2 times it by 45 years of my expected productivity. They got that total. They stuck it into the trust account. I've also been told that it starts with $700,000 and then goes up from there. They might not use the income from your parents. And in my case, it'd be hard to tell what the income is because I'm an orphan. So anyways, that's how I figure it works. The trust account can be accessed when application to release funds, mortgage, or offset an account is made. The petitioner actually lent the statutory entity its own funds back, and the legality charging interest on funds that are not loaned is a major dishonor on the petition. Now, I kind of think everything that they're doing is kind of legal, but if I give you $10 and then I say, hey, can I borrow $10 off you, and then you give me back my own $10 and charge me interest on money, I think there's something racketeering. I'm going to look in the criminal law on that, but I just think there is something really wrong with that. So, yeah, anyways. So, in this process, the government has legally made the money. The banks have legally accessed the money to purchase the asset, provided that they have in a savings account 10% of the funds allocated to any other loan, for lack of a better word. And the Canadian dollar has real value, 25 million trust accounts with over $2 million each. Then the note, alleged loan, was converted and securitized debt and removed from the books, legally skirting generally accepted accounting principles. That's how they can do a double negative entry on their ledger, is they put it off books. And it is legal to do that with mortgages. It's in the Bank Act. I saw it. So anyways, it's not in the Bank Act. It's in the accounting. You can put things on books or off books. But anyways, that's how. So when they went for the bailout, and the bailout was where in Canada was worse than in the States, but in Canada we don't call it a bailout. We call it an absorption of bad debt. So what happened was the banks, all this on-book debt that people were defaulting on, they just handed that to the federal government. But even the people in the Treasury or in the federal government didn't look at the off-books accounts, which there was no debt. They're still sitting high. So anyways, the banks got paid for their on-book debt, and they already been paid for their off-book debt to cover their on-book debt. It's just bizarre. So maybe this will get some lawyers or something to get that money back. Okay, so there we go. And I'll point to those items in a minute. A lawyer conflict of interest is apparent there. Here, the statutory entity would have never legally bound the respondent if the deceitful, dishonorable processes and practices were disclosed at the time of consent under Bills of Exchange Act, blah, 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 blah. All claims made by the petitioner should be dismissed. So that's just being deceptive and dishonorable. You can look up what that is in the Bills of Exchange Act. I put a whole whack of them in here. Okay, part two. But if the aforementioned is just a fantastic fantasy and the petitioner can make money from nothing, and there's some affidavits there from the head lawyer from the Federal Reserve, and I'll just click through those, and there was nothing backing the Canadian dollar, then it looks like on the surface the statutory entity is in possible dishonor with the petitioner. Okay, so now this is kind of, I got a couple parts here. One is I'm asking them, you know, did you access my trust? Two, there's a conflict of interest with the lawyer dealing with my account. And now three, this is the next kind of group that they'll have to deal with. The first mortgage was 5 years, 100, 1800 a month. Well, actually, it was lower than that. On the first year, I was actually 1700, but I was paying 1800 each month. Demanded 2300 per month without giving a reason why. They basically just called me. I was at the bank and there was a note on the account. So they called me and the guy says, well, we want $2,300 a month. Why? Well, we just want $2,300 a month. So I said, well, I'm not paying that. I just got my mortgage, right? So anyways, I didn't pay that. I declined their offer to increase payments and continued to pay $1,800 as best as possible. On the third year, the petitioner made notice to the statutory entity was behind in the property tax. The contract mortgage was to pay about $1,800 per month, with a portion of this being held in a separate bank account so the petitioner can pay down property tax yearly. Upon completion of the five-year mortgage, the petitioner claimed all taxes and payments were settled and current for the new two-year mortgage started May 1st. According to the resort municipality, the accounting on this matter goes $2,077 outstanding, $27. There's only 1 year, the first year when they took the mortgage from the other bank, that bank didn't pay the property tax. So there was $2,067 for property tax that was owed. So after about 50 or 60 discouraging payments of $1,800 or so, for a total of about $90,000 to $100,000, the alleged mortgage was paid down less than $16,000, all because the petitioner failed to check at the beginning of the mortgage if the petitioner had paid the property tax or the previous bank, whatever, to the current year. And they perpetuated this $2,000 debt, even though it's being paid at the muni, but they just perpetuated this for years. And I've talked to other people. They something similar has happened to them, not on the grand scale it's happened to me. But anyways, that's... Then the statutory entity renewed the mortgage on May 1st. So I got a new mortgage. Everything was closed, done, caught up. It was a done deal. Brand new mortgage. And then... they demanded an extra from, I think it's $140 a month to $381 in addition. That was when I was just sat down to sign this new mortgage. Okay, fine. Whatever. I signed it. Added to my monthly account. Payment of $130 to cover so-called back taxes. The total monthly payments were as follows. Principal interest were... $1,278 plus property tax and alleged arrears, $506 for a total monthly payment of $17. So I'm right back to where I was on my 5 year, but my interest rate is half the rate. So it should be half. So 30 days later, I went in to pay my first mortgage payment of $1,700, which should be $1,400. And they wanted more money. They wanted another $500 a month per year for a year to pay down. So $500 a month after, that's $6,000. My property tax is only $1,400 or $1,500 a year. So this is just bizarre for them. Anyways, they threatened me with foreclosure because they said I was 3 months behind in my payments on a mortgage which I just got for them. And I was only 30 days on this new mortgage. So... anyways, they're, and I got some flack from my wife on that too. How can you be so stupid to falling for that? So anyways, you know, at the point I'm just saying, okay, whatever, whatever. And then this was pretty well one of the straws that broke the camel's back, and how they treated me was brutal. And then their collections department, when I fell behind, because I was paying it in two steps. You know, I would pay the $1,700, then I'd pay an $800 in another 2 weeks or a week later when I got some more money together, because I never really got big whacks of money like that. So, anyways. So, the statutory, I struggled to honor the monthly obligation to no avail, and then it was decided to halt all payments after depositing $506, which was on the paper. That's what I was supposed to, into my tax account. That was what's supposed to be paid each month for taxes. That's what we kind of agreed on. And then I noticed that they were taking the money from my tax account, pay interest only. So I says, nope, that's over. You just, no, wrong. Can't do it. So then on January 4th, I went down, or my fictitious went down, and I zeroed the balance. So I paid my property tax. I went into the city hall. I paid it. It pointed to me as the payee, not to the bank. And I removed the bank from the payee. Then on January 27th, I received a letter from a local agent, the local bank, explaining that they paid my property tax on June 6th, and stating the balance of the mortgage account was a surplus of $734. This is in conflict with a printout of the tax account that I got on March. So when I pay it directly to the muni, and so what account are they talking about this? So their accounting is wonky on this. Had been zeroed, the balance other than the $506 statute deposited. No other payments have been made. So I don't know, maybe there was some other payments. That doesn't make sense. We'll see that in court, what that's all about. And then I delivered several courtesy notices unrebutted to the petitioner, basically their lawyer, and he never disputed them. So he owes me 1,000 troy ounces of silver because I got this document from the Supreme Court that he stands behind. So, and this other lawyer, so maybe that's why they brought this other lawyer in and from Toronto and is doing this funky stuff. So I don't know. But an unrebutted affidavit claim or charge stands as the truth in commerce, which is pretty well true. That's why I'm going to probably come at them from admiralty law, is because you're guilty until proven innocent, so they'll have to prove their innocence on this. So anyways, so there you have it. Now we're going to start chipping through the item 12 and the other items that I have here. Okay, so this is form number 3, and it's the counterclaim. So I'm going through, I've listed the Toronto Bank and two of the lawyers, and then the legal firm here. Let me see what else. Claim of the defendants bringing counterclaim, statement of facts. Yeah, I hope I put the right defendants in whatever. So what I wanted to bring here is, this is my countersuit. 1,000 troy ounces of silver for breach of courtesy notice contract. The Toronto Bank legal counsel. So basically I sent legal counsel 4 or 5 courtesy notices. They're in the other video, and he never rebutted, never came back. So I would say we had a deal. And then I got the Supreme Court documents, which basically he broke the agreement that we had, the contract that we had. All mortgage payments refunded back upon lack of proof against the loan was not paid in full upon acceptance of note, mortgage, no claim, the note was defective, restore all rights, relinquish all interest, claim to this, to my strata lot, deceptive banking practices regardless, collection of payment property taxes, $10 million, including but not limited to stress and other forms of personal harm, and fundamental economic damage. So basically 1,000 troy ounces, get off title of my house, refund all my mortgage payments, and $10 million. So that is my counterclaim to the bank that holds the alleged mortgage of my property. So anyways, I don't think there are very many people that countersuit the way this is here. And I, again, had to rush this, so I would have taken a lot more time on this to fill out the form and specify and other forms of personal harm. That's very vague. But anyways, I gave a copy of this to the CFO, Chief Financial Officer, to the bank in Vancouver. So this, along with a whole bunch of other stuff. So maybe that got their attention, because if I only put like a couple $1,000, I would not get the attention of the CFO. So anyways, that's let's see if there's anything else down here. Nope, just sign, blah blah blah. Okay, there we have it. Okay, so let's go through form 67 here. So the top part, response to petition. So orders consented to. There's really not much opposed. You can see that all their points here, I have pretty well opposed all of them. And this is just kind of their address and some other minuscule stuff that I don't really care about. But the real meat of it is, so you gotta remember, I put this together in like 14 days plus. I've been working super, super hard, and it seems as soon as I filed the application, bang, all my work stopped. And I haven't been so busy in years. Like, I was turning down work, just weird coincidence that when I'm trying to do this counter or, you know, defend myself against the bank, I get so much work. And then it stops as soon as the Supreme Court application is submitted. So strange, strange, strange. Okay, so the declaration of a valid mortgage is in default is defective as per the undisclosed conflict of interest with Ian Tate, whatever, as the said lawyer was and has been working for the petitioner. So this is a key point, which I'll go into other. It's black and white conflict of interest. Local branch conveyancing contract. Conflict of interest was never conveyed. I can just kind of let you read that there. If this conflict was disclosed, the respondent would have had an opportunity for seeking competent independent counsel that would have afforded him proper disclosure to the respondent. Without legal disclosure, the respondent could not have given legal consent and not suffered fundamental economic damage. Okay, let's go into this thing here. As per the note signed, so this is the kind of the mortgage agreement I'm calling a note. The acceptance notice of honor of this note constituted payment in full. I signed that note. They accessed my trust account. Even if they didn't access my trust account, it's like a check. If you give me a check and I give you some goods in exchange, and there's no defect in the check, bingo, it is a done deal. No defect in, and plus they monetized it, so they sold off that actual mortgage to other companies and pension funds and everything else, and they've also converted it, which is called monetization, into other forms of cash or currency. Has proven the note and petitioner failed to return the note defect. Basically, I signed a promissory note. They haven't told me it was defective, so bingo, the house is paid for. It is believed the petitioner dishonorably accessed. Okay, so this is what I'm saying. When I signed the note, they went into my trust account and took the money out. So at the Treasury in Victoria, the petitioner failed to adhere to generally accepting accounting principles. Yeah, this is probably a little bit off now because they just moved that money from the from my trust account to off books. So again, you know, I was kind of rushed and under the gun, and this has been a bit of a challenge for me. So here's another part, set off negative side of the ledger. Result, the respondent was dishonorably guided into signing a document that holds him liable for the amount claimed by the petitioner. So the respondent is me, not the statutory entity. The statutory entity kind of signed it, but I'm responsible for it. So here we go. Okay, so this is going through all the items that they're claiming. So this is a moot point. Mortgage instrument process creation of the instrument is defective due to the respondents unable to give legal consent for lack of proper disclosure by the lawyers. Basically saying I couldn't sign this document, legally sign it. Okay, before a declaration amount can be assigned, there must be proof of loss, proof of harm, proof of loan. Now, they have kind of skewed the definition of loan, so they could probably prove loan, but they can't prove loss or harm. So I have to focus on the definitions. I'll grab different Oxford dictionaries from around the world of what a loan is. So if I give you something and then I borrow that same thing back, is that a loan or is it just returned? Anyways, that's kind of goofy there. Proof of debt. Yeah, that's another one. They're going to have a hell of a time proving debt other than from the loan side, the on-books account. And if they make the money from nothing using fractional lending rules, then there really is no debt either. So the legally valid passes generally accepted accounting principles. Well, they can do that if they move it off books. But if they securitize or monetize my note and make money from nothing, that's a double, they have to do a double negative entry for that, and they're not. So in that case, they're not following generally accepted accounting principles. Under fractional lending rules, there can never be any loss, as the note provided by a respondent legally allowed the petitioner to monetize the respondent's note or access my trust account, which is true. So can the petitioner produce documentation regarding the history? We've already covered this in the other video there. Before an order is made, petitioner must prove otherwise to the commonly accepted facts that the alleged amount was monetized from the notes signed by the respondent. The onus is on the petitioner. Basically, someone's walking up to me, you owe me money, prove it. And that's where admiralty law, I'm coming back at them probably through admiralty law. Okay, the amount to redeem the lands has been in acceptance and monetized of the loan application, mortgage application, credit application has been redeemed to full value by the petitioner. The petitioner is required legally to justify the claim before any debarring of the respondent can. Now, this is just a goofy word that they put in their claim, so I have to look up what debarring is, but it probably is not good for me anyways. Just the other one, moot point. Hopefully I spelled moot correctly. Okay, so let's scroll down a little bit more. And mortgage instrument process creation. An instrument is defective due to the response unable to give legal consent for lack of proper disclosure by the lawyer's undisclosed conflict of interest petitioner. Yep. So, you know, even there's in legal terms, like if there is a conflict of interest, they can sign a piece of paper that releases one party, then they can represent the other party. He would never, ever blow off the bank because they make so much money. That's their bread and butter. So they might see me once every 10 or 15 years for a couple grand, but they see the banks every month for $10,000 or $20,000. So, there's a protocol for stopping conflict of interest by releasing one side, and the side has to be notified. The bank will have to be notified with documents, which I know they never did. Well, I don't know for sure, but I'm assuming for sure. Before a declaration of amount can be assigned, there must be proof of loss, proof of harm, proof of debt that is legally valid and passes. Okay, I'm going back to the accounting under fractional lending rules. You can never. Okay, so I don't know why I keep going back to this. Okay, can the petitioner produce document regarding origin? We've already covered this. There's one thing. Order such a petitioner must prove otherwise to the commonly accepted. Okay, so this is all standard stuff. Legal basis. Okay, so I think this is all done. Yeah, their forms are kind of goofy here. Okay, now I'm going through the stuff here. Okay, the accommodation party. This is from the Bills of Exchange Act, so that's where I got the accommodation party. There's also a terminology called accommodating party. The bill, a person who has signed a bill as drawer, acceptor, endorser without receiving value, therefore, and for the purpose of lending his name to some other person, marginal note liability of party. So I'm still getting kind of twisted here because there's two entities. There's a fact, a fiction. There's a uppercase name that they created, lowercase name that I was born with, which is the real me. So anyways, hopefully I can sort everything out in my mind before we go to court. The accommodating party is liable on the bill to the holder for value and is immaterial whether the holder took the bill, he knew the party. Yeah, basically that's kind of what I said previously in the video. The statutory entity signed the document. The accommodating party is the real party, which is actually liable for it. So I can't go the other way. If the accommodating party, me, signs a document, I can't hold the fictitious me accountable for it because there's nothing there. So, okay. The Bank Act. Okay, so I'm chipping through. Deposit acceptance. A bank may without intervention. I'm just going to kind of let you. Execution of trust. So this keyword here. Let me see. Yeah. So trust. A bank is not bound to see the execution of any trust to which any deposit made under the authority of the Act is subject. When a bank has notice of trust. So anyways, there. I've been part of my case is dealing with the trust, the word trust, the account trust. So they have it in the Bank Act here. So you can take a boo at that. Okay, I've bolded stuff that I want to discuss here. So a bank shall not open an account is or forms part of a registered product. Okay, the municipality of Whistler is, a registered product. I can't open up an account in the name of the municipality of Whistler or kind of imply that I have an account that is on behalf of the municipality of Whistler. Tax, only the municipality is charging me property tax. So setting up a tax account to pay property tax to the municipality of Whistler, I'm kind of trying to get at here that this a tax account is not me. I don't charge tax. Only the municipality does. It's their tax account. So they illegally set up an account that is through a couple steps. A registered product or a registered company or a corporation, which is a corporation of the municipality of Whistler. So that's kind of what I'm getting at there. Name of a customer, enter into agreement with a customer for prescribed product or service that it forms part of a registered product. The registered product is municipality of Whistler tax account, property tax account. Now, anyways, I think there's something there. It's just wrong. No matter what they do in the tax account, the property tax usually gets paid anyways, because otherwise they'll go for tax sale, and then their paper that they have on my place would end up going away. So, yeah. Information about all charges applicable to the registered product. They never told me about transferring money from the municipality tax account to their pay interest only, all this other stuff. They didn't do that. And maybe that's why they didn't send me the actual mortgage agreement, only the table of contents, because some of this stuff isn't in there. Or if it is, it's an absolute breach. Be notified of any increase in those charges. They didn't do this. Information about the bank's procedures relating to complaints. I never got that, but that's just a very small point. Any amount charged in connection with a loan, interest for the purposes of the cost of borrowing means any amount. Yeah, if they're trying to define, and that's again the lawyer that was doing the conveyancing never really brought this up, saying yeah they can do this and they can do that and they can, you know, they make the money from nothing or they got it from your trust account, you know, whatever. So none of this was really clarified to me by the lawyer or by the banks. So any charge prescribed to be included in the cost of borrowing. So their general thing, it's not the cost of loan, it's cost of borrowing. So they're playing goofy with English here. It should be cost of borrowing / loan, or cost of borrowing and or loan. Yeah, I'm starting to grasp all the funkiness of their terminology, their English, and how they're playing games with the words here. Natural person, that is me. This is fascinating that this is actually in the Bank Act. Now, in sentence structure, grammar, syntax, and stuff, I will be able to shred in hopefully about 6 months their mortgage contract, which will my goal is to shred it to allow anyone that has a mortgage contract with the bank to actually just walk away from their loan and have the house clear title. And there is this natural person here is me. That's you. That's your real flesh and blood. So in the syntax and how they did the sentence structure here, I'm still not clear on this, but I would interpret this as a bank shall not make a loan to a natural person. A bank shall not make a loan to a real person. Only the fictitious uppercase person. That's what I read in this, and I'll have to go to the Styles manual and all the other funky stuff to back up that. But that's why they don't want me to enter court as a real person, as a fact person. They only deal in fiction in the courts. So, anyways, here we go. If the bank makes a loan respect to the disclosure requirements applied to loan secured by a mortgage, the bank shall disclose to the borrower at the prescribed time and place, prescribed form. So, wherever I sign this document, either at the lawyer's office or at the bank's, they're supposed to disclose all the stuff to me. And again, I'm starting to build a bit of a history that they're not disclosing stuff. So, you know, that's just a little point there. A bank shall not directly or indirectly charge or receive any sum for the provision of any prescribed products or services unless the charge is made by express agreement between. So that's, again, they didn't tell me they accessed their trust account, my trust account. They didn't, if they're fractional lending, they didn't really tell me they're making the money from my 10% deposit on the place, which then makes 90%, or someone else's savings account or whatever. So anyways, this is all right from the Bank Act, and you guys can just, you can either copy this right. A bank shall not impose undue pressure on or coerce a person into obtaining a product or service from a particular person. The particular person, see, they're changing it, including the bank. Is the bank a person, a particular person, and any of its affiliates? So, anyways, they recommended the lawyer to me. Oh, go, here's a list of lawyers. So, but they didn't coerce. Well, kind of, I guess they did. I have to look up the word coerce, but anyways. For the purposes of where the bank accepts a bill of exchange is the note drawn on it, payable, demands paid, da 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 da, or make an advance. This is what I, so a bank is deemed to lend money or make an advance. So did they lend me money or did they make an advance for a short period of time before? Because I think there's a rescission act, or there's a period of time when they actually apply to the trust account. There's 6 days or something like that before they actually get the offset into their bank account, or they can do something with it, or so anyways, maybe. But I don't see anywhere make an advance on. Okay, holder in due course. Let's take a look. He took the bill in good faith. Okay, this is kind of coming back to me. They gave me a bill to pay $365,000. So I took the bill in good faith. So BC Law Society Code of Ethics, conflict of interest means the existence of substantial risk that a lawyer's loyalty or representation of a client would be materially or adversely affected by the lawyer's own interest or the lawyer's duties of another client. Well, that's pretty straightforward. If he didn't tell me he's working for the bank, he makes most of his money from the bank, and I'm in there signing documents that's legally binding both parties, the statutory entity and the natural person, and he's not even bringing any of this up. It's just, yeah, sign here, initial here, and stamp, thank you very much, see you later. Like, no more than probably 5 minutes in his office, and he walked away with a couple grand. So, yeah. let's take a look down here. BC Law Code of Conduct defines means of full and fair disclosure of all information relevant to the person's decision. This lawyer never gave me that. So you can see that if they, I don't know if a code of ethics is strong enough to have this, have them penalized or have them change their policies. Basically, he just went against the code of ethics. I don't know if this is actually a law. So, anyways, the client has been fully informed and of and voluntarily, after disclosure, has given consent. I was never given disclosure. I could never have given consent then. Canons of legal ethics. A lawyer owes a duty to the state, not to the client, to maintain its integrity and its law. A lawyer owes duty to the state, not the client, because it is not there. A lawyer should not aid, counsel, or assist any person in an act in any way contrary to the law. Yeah, well, I'd say this, if this is law, the code of ethics is law, then they have definitely violated this. So, let me take a look. A lawyer should disclose to the client all the circumstances of the lawyer's relation to the parties and interest in or in connection with that might influence whether the client selects or continues to retain a lawyer. The lawyer. A lawyer must not act where there is a conflict of interest between lawyer, a client, or between clients. Pretty straightforward. Under penalty of death, subsection 6 of the criminal code or whatever should be in there. Because if there's no teeth or bite behind the code of ethics of the law society on this, I'm sitting on the fence. I don't know if there will be anything of this because I don't think this really is law. I think this is kind of more a suggestion of how the lawyers should work. A lawyer should endeavor by all fair and honorable means to obtain for the client the benefit of any and every remedy defense that is authorized by law. Okay, there's a couple things. They haven't alternate dispute mechanism. They haven't suggested that. There's a couple other things that they're not. So again, this is another area where the lawyers have violated their trust. Steadfast, bear in mind the great trust and performs within without the bounds of law. The office of a lawyer does not permit such demand for any client violation of the law in any manner of fraud or channel or whatever. So the bank, through its collusion with the lawyer, is basically saying, don't tell them what's really in the contract. Don't tell them anything about this. Just get them to sign it. So, I think there's another issue there. So this is, okay, so we'll chip through some more here. A lawyer should assist in maintaining the honor and integrity of the legal profession. Should expose before proper tribunals, without fear or favor, unprofessional or dishonest conduct by any other lawyer, and should accept without hesitation a retainer against any lawyer. So, again, I tried to hire lawyers in town to represent me for the foreclosure. They all said no, conflict of interest. Now, maybe that's their excuse for not pursuing, you know, I'll be hard-pressed to find a lawyer that would even consider taking on the quagmire that I've kind of got going here. So no client is entitled to receive or should a lawyer render any services or advice involving disloyalty to the state, disrespect for the judicial system. Duh. So, okay. The public and other members of the profession honorably and with integrity. A lawyer has the duty to carry on the practice. Okay, there's not much integrity so far that I've seen. This is the alternative dispute resolution. They've never offered that to me. The lawyers working for the bank have never offered that to the bank, I'm assuming. A lawyer must perform all legal services undertaken on a client's behalf to the standard of a competent lawyer. That's kind of a, you know, once I break down the syntax of these words, I think that's going to mean something totally different. Honesty and candor. Fail. A lawyer must, honest and candid, must inform the client of all information known to the lawyer. Okay, so here's a note for the lawyer right there. Well, I didn't know. then we go back, well, a competent lawyer would know this information, would know there's a conflict of interest, would know that there is no value on the client's end. He's actually already paid for the place and blah, 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 blah. So, encouraging compromise. Now, a lawyer must advise, encourage a client to compromise or settle this a dispute. So, there it is. They're not doing that. Statement of detailed amounts charged as fees and disbursements. I never got a bill or an invoice from the lawyer for doing the conveyancing. So, that, and the lawyer doesn't have any proof of payment from me. And even if they did, there's still a conflict of interest because he still does do work for the banks. That seems to be his niche. So either way, you know. So under UCC rule, the secured party must give value. I gave them the promissory note. They access the trust. And also they have the property, they have what they appears to be legal access to change title to my property that I purchased with my note and my trust account funds. Or fractional lending rules, they've already got the money. So it's, yeah. So the UCC is a pretty huge organization for inter, you know, all banks and governments and military and everything. When you're going from country to country, even within the countries, some countries call it different. I think we call it bills of exchange instead of UCC, but it still all falls under the UCC law. So anyways, there we go. So this is the end of the stuff. The end of the document is here. And I just put my email address down there. So that's, again, there's no closure on this. So I'm starting to figure out the kind of the proper structure for documents. And we will see 6 months from now how I talk and how my contract said as I draw up to deal with this. They're going to look totally different. There's been a huge evolution from my first video to now. But okay, so now I'm going to go through the items that I have included in my affidavit. Okay, so if you do a search on Google for statutory entity, straw man, faux man, or just search uppercase lettering birth certificate, that's a really good way to start. You'll start popping up with some of the history of where this got its start. And I'm not going to read any of this, but you guys can kind of go full screen on your YouTube browser and kind of pick your way through this. Just, you know, hit stop. And so this was item one in my N1A because it's two-part here. See, they're talking natural person perpetrates a crime, but legal person may also commit a crime. Kind of a, so they're definitely defining a legal person or a fiction person and a natural person. So we definitely have, I've established that there is this, there is a long history of this. A legal person is simply an organization of natural persons. So, domestic artificial persons. So, it's going to be hard for them to deny that the uppercase lettering is just a figment of my imagination. So, also, I put item one, which also corresponds in my affidavit. So, I put it at the beginning on this, on the other side. So, put it to the right justification. So, when they're flipping through, they can actually see quickly the item because a staple is on the left-hand side and it would have hidden this. So, that's just a little brain fart that I did. Okay, let's do another one here. Okay, holder in due course. Item 2. The holder in due course is a holder who has taken a bill complete, regular on the face. And I'm just going to, I'll just scroll down and you guys can just read through this. Title of a person who negotiates a bill is defective. by fraud, duress, or force, or fear, or other unlawful means. So that's kind of what I'm getting at. The title is defective. If they try to take title in my house, it will be defective because they have gotten it through unlawful means. Presumption of value. Okay, here we go. Item 3. This is International Monetary Fund. I think everyone's heard of that. And under the present system, banks do not have to wait for depositors to appear and make funds available before they can on-lend or intermediate those funds. Rather, they create their own funds deposits in the act of lending. This fact can be verified in the description of the money creation system in many central bank statements. And it is obvious to anyone who has ever lent money and created the resulting book entries. So this is International Monetary Fund. Again, this here looks like they're making money from nothing. Now, if that's the case, fine, then there's no value on their part. But if actually the other part of this is that they access the trusts, which would give the currency value, would also put the banks in check. And what you're seeing here is the fractional lending portion of it, because they don't want people to know about their trust accounts, because that's their money. That's their. So I would say people would be riding or, you know, voting totally different if they knew that the, you know, their trust accounts were being fleeced to bomb other countries into the dark ages, or, you know, it would just give a different. Now they're attached to the decisions that are made on their behalf with their money. Right now, it looks like the banks make the money from nothing. Ah, who cares? Yeah, blah, 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 right? There's this big detachment. So anyways, that's a whole bunch of these little documents help. So here's another one, item 4. This is just an article out of a paper. Commercial banks create checkbook money whenever they grant a loan simply by adding new deposit dollars to accounts on their books in exchange for borrower's IOU. So there we go. This is what I was getting at. My promissory note, my mortgage application is an IOU or a note, which then they just created the money at the back end to actually fulfill that IOU. So again, no harm can be put to them, no loss. You know, so money creation bookkeeping isn't a gimmickry for banks are creating money based on a borrower's promise to pay, IOU, promissory note, mortgage agreement, whatever you want to call that, which in turn is often secured or backed by valuable items a borrower owns. So they're lending me money that they created from nothing, but then they want the house as collateral. They want all this. It's just like, it's bizarre. Someone obtaining an auto loan, for example, might use the new car as collateral. A home improvement loan might be secured by the value of the house. Da 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 da. So there is. Now I got the Bank of England coming up here. My computer is bogging down here. Okay. Liabilities. Da 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 da. Okay, let's go down to this part here. That is, banks extend credit by creating money. Now, Constitution of Canada states quite clearly, only the federal government has legal authority to loan or make Canadian currency. So, I personally don't think, and it's also the same in the States and other countries, so that leads me to believe that they're not creating money. It looks like they are, because they're taking the trust account money and putting it off books. And then on books, they're just relending the same money. So, anyways, either way, there's no risk, no harm. They can't prove it. So let's go up here. And item 5, so let's go to item 6. Okay, birth certificate. Registration number, so there's a whole bunch of numbers there. division of vital statistics, my name, all uppercase there. And then as we go down to Vancouver, is upper and lowercase. So Vancouver does exist. I do not exist. Director of Vital Statistics, date issued. All this stuff is fine. And my registration date is right there. Uppercase, certified, exact, da-da-da-da. That means it doesn't exist. This whole thing is a fiction. This is also certificate of birth. It's not a certificate of birth. Actually, it's certificate of death. That's why this is all uppercase, and it looks like it's in a continuous box here, which means that it isn't on this page. And it is also possible that this whole thing is a continuous box all the way around, which means that the whole thing, everything within the box, doesn't exist. Province of British Columbia. See, this is uppercase and lower, and also the box looks like it's broken. So the only thing really on this document is this Province of British Columbia is the only thing that's really legal here, because this is above the box. Because if you see this fine line that goes underneath and then joins back, it's a continuous line all the way around. So even if this is broken in the box, this is the only real valid thing on this birth certificate, if I'm interpreting the Styles manual. Birthplace, uppercase, birth date. So again, uppercase, these don't exist. Date issued. And vital statistics. Weird. So this is upper and lowercase here. So this is a valid sentence inside the box, which makes it not valid. Okay, I've already covered this in another video, but on the back of the birth certificate, revenue receipt number, there's my account number, and for Treasury use only. So it's basically saying this account number here is only for the Treasury. So that's how I can get them to offset and get access. That's part of the formula or the things that you need to know to actually start getting control of your trust. Okay, so this is a affidavit from one of the top lawyers for the Federal Reserve. And I'm just going to kind of scroll through it, and it's and you can read as, let me see if I do the page down, if that works. Okay. Oops. Yeah, I don't think this is working too good. So, generally accepted accounting principles. Okay. You can just stop and read this stuff as I go down. You should be able to read this if you go full screen. newly issued credit or money is similar to or equivalent to a promissory note, my mortgage, which may be treated as a deposit of money. They never gave me a receipt for my deposit of money. There we go. That's my point that I've been trying to make through this thing. One of the points. When a bank grants a loan, they create new money. Now, this is one of the head lawyers for the Federal Reserve. Now, it could be that this is actually the myth is actually true, but I think the back end of this is to actually access the trust account, put it off books, which then again makes it look like they're making money, they're creating new money, when all they're doing is taking money that's already been created legally at one time and hiding it and putting it back into circulation on books. So this is my argument too. They accepted my promissory note as a credit application. See, the plaintiff never, in fact, lent any of its own pre-existing money, credit, or assets as considered to purchase the note or credit agreement. Yeah, it's... Yeah, so this is kind of my point too. I actually, with my note, gave them money or gave them access to my trust account, and they're now saying I owe them money. So I've given them $365,000. They put it in one pocket and they say, okay, now you owe us $365,000. So there you guys go. You can this guy's credentials are pretty impressive, and since he's done tons of stuff for governments and 20 years, Federal Reserve. Yeah, so this guy kind of knows, but, you know, as in the military, it's a need-to-know basis. So I still think the guy, the trust is there. So anyways, I think he's just still, even though he's not involved in the Federal Reserve, the reason he got to that high standing is because he believed in this system here, fractional lending. So anyways... there's that one. Okay, here's a letter. This is tax letter item 9. So basically what they're saying here is a notice is to provide you with information relating to your property taxes. They paid my property tax here of $1,581, so it's all square. Now, you'd think by policy they would be doing this every year. On June 6, and there's a credit in the municipality's implied municipality property tax right there, account. Only governments are allowed to tax citizens as far as I'm nowhere. So property is, because this is in the municipality of Whistler, this has to be the municipality's property tax, plus there's the mortgage number, which could be cross-referenced to the municipality. So this is the property within the municipality of Whistler tax account, and was in a surplus. Now, down here, the tax account balance assumes that there are no arrears on your account. So if the account goes into arrears, they take money from the municipalities of Whistler tax account and put it towards their interest, not the principal, the interest on money that they created from nothing or borrowed or took from my trust account. So there you have it. Again, the right hand doesn't know what the left hand's doing, but... Okay, so this is the printout, the last payment that I made, and I put it directly into the Municipality of Whistler's property tax account. So this is all the information, interest. This is, so these two are mine. This is the tax account here. So that was on the agreement that we had. I was to pay $506, and it was supposed to go into my tax account. Now, as you can see, as I pay money, it's not going in there. There's this payment, but the D means delete, delete, bing, bing, bing. So they're deleting money from this account to put it over into the interest only. So I'm paying $1,100 interest only, $400, $900 on interest. Like, come on. All using the guise of the tax thing. So, anyways, there you go. Okay, so this is the off-balance sheet stuff that I was talking about. So I'm just going to let you, you can hopefully see this and read through this. And I'm just going to cancel this down. So, and now we can go to some of, if you look up the definition of off-balance sheet, you can find these definitions here. So off-balance sheet does not have legal claim or responsibility for. So that would be my trust account taking the money out from my trust account. See if the loans are securitized or sold off as investments. However, the securitized debt is not kept on the books. And they are harder to track. Can become hidden liabilities. Collaterals, obligations, for instance, may become toxic. So again, there's that's that whole toxic derivatives that they were doing. So there you go.